Good morning, Center Church.
Good morning.
What a beautiful fall morning we have together in from the coolness of autumn into the warmth of Jesus's love. For those of you who I have not yet had the privilege of meeting, my name is Chris Mathewson. I'm your new transitional pastor. I've met some of you. Some of you I've met and I will have forgotten, so I ask for your grace in advance. And I'm better the second time around usually. By the third or I promise by the ninth time I'll have it down pat. But I look forward to meeting each and every one of you. My wife Lisa is just walking in the back. You guys wave hi with my three children. If you hear noise in the sanctuary, the preacher's kids are usually guilty. So you can, no, they're good. They're glad to be here with us this morning. I'm just so grateful for the opportunity to be serving with you in a season of transition, and I look forward to getting to know each and every one of you in the time we have together. One of the benefits of being part of a smaller congregation is it's more intimate, and I look forward to having the chance to sit, whether it's over a cup of coffee or wherever you're comfortable in this climate, to have that time and to get to know one another. As we gather for worship, we want to draw our attention to a couple things on the back of your announcements. We have a community prayer and praise meeting every Monday at 6 to 7. It starts on October 26. There's some small group gatherings for 4th to 6th grades. It's like a Bible study on Friday nights between 5 and 6:15, and that starts October 30th. And then we are sponsoring kind of a harvest event this year, a Trunk or Treat Festival, on October 31st, on Halloween itself, which is a Saturday, from 2 to 4. My family will be here, and we look forward to that time celebrating the harvest. And Brian's worked diligently to put together a little pamphlet to hang out to folks, welcome them to our church. And Nate has worked hard on organizing the event itself, along with Denise, to just have a wonderful outreach event for our community in this time. As we begin our time in worship, friends in Christ, we turn to God's word always. He is the type of God that speaks to us first because we need it. We are lost without him. So out of his benevolence, out of his kindness, he comes to us and he speaks his truth about who he is. He does this very poignantly in the Psalms, and I want to draw us into a spirit of worship from Psalm 95 this morning. Come. Let us sing for joy to the Lord. Not something Presbyterians are particularly good at, but let's work on it. Let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God and the King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care.
Thank you, Pastor. Good morning, Center Church. Let's stand. Worship the God of heaven.
Shining down on me when the world all has
Are shouted out in heaven all the time. And if I can get my phone to open up, I will shout the names of Jesus as well. I looked up the names of Jesus. Jesus, Alpha and Omega, Emmanuel, King of Kings, Light of the World, Morning Star, Morning Prince, Wonderful Counselor, Lamb of God, Savior of the World, the Good Shepherd, the Way, the Lord of Lords, Anointed One, Bread of Life. That's what we need to be shouting. Amen? Amen.
Follow.
Song called Waymaker, and I think you've heard this before. If you know it, please sing along. If you don't, let's just prepare our hearts for worship.
You are here, moving in our midst. Worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. 'Cause you are way maker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. And you are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you.
You are waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. God, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who. That is who you are. That is who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Cause you are way maker, miracle.
promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Please be seated.
So appreciative for Mark for calling out the names of Jesus. So much of what we do in worship is declaring what is true about the God that's brought us from death to life, and giving him credit, glory, and honor for who he is. We do this in the way that we praise. We also do this in the way that we confess. As we just sang, he is the light in our darkness, the darkness of our sin. So we confess not out of shame, but out of freedom, because we already know that he's chosen to love us despite our sin. So we are free to bring our burdens to him. Let us do that now in a season of prayer, followed by a prayer of thanksgiving, and then the Lord's prayer to follow that. Holy Father, we come this morning as both broken and beloved, as both sinner and saint, because of the work of Jesus. Hear us now, Lord, as we confess silently in our hearts those things this last week that we have done, and those things that we have left undone. Lord, hear our prayer. Great mercy, Lord, we give thanks and receive the freedom and the grace that is only offered, the salvation from our sin that is only offered through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. And as we give thanks, we praise him for the ways that he's been at work in our lives, in our community. This week, we pray for eyes to see and ears to hear the ways that he's at work that we have not yet seen, that we might bend ourselves as an act of worship, offering our whole selves to him as he builds his kingdom through us, his bride, who have been called out to be set apart, to be salt and light in the world that you love and that you're redeeming through him. And as we praise him, let us also pray as he taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And give us as we forgive all debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I took it easy on you guys this morning. We only confessed our sins silently for about 30 seconds. My list was longer than you guys, it must have been, because I could have kept going. And I interned under one guy who is just an old school Presbyterian pastor. And one week he wanted to make a point. And so they were doing like that exercise where you confess. He like watched his watch for like 5 minutes. And it was downright awkward. And people were looking up like, is he for reals? Is this going on? And then he led them through an assurance of pardon. And he just looked at them with a lot of love, but some sternness. He goes, lest you forget how much you need a Savior. It's good to be with you guys in worship today. I'm sorry we had to be absent from you last week. We appreciated your prayers and are absent. We would not be here had the tests that we took last week not come back negative, which they did. Lisa's still not able to be at her school. They closed it for 2 weeks. We live in a different age, do we not? But we are tested negative, and so we're glad to be in your midst. I'm again grateful for Lindsay. She came into our home. Lisa sterilized the whole first floor, and we just wanted to be safe. Lindsay was so gracious to film in our home, and I was glad that we could be with you at least that way last week. But here we are together in worship. I finally get to bring God's word to you in person, a day that I've been looking forward to since I started the process of getting to know your session almost 2 months ago now. I think my first interview with you all was in mid-August, if I'm not mistaken. And so it's a day that I've been anticipating. And we're going to begin, as I often do when I enter a season of transitional ministry, with a familiar passage, because you're just getting to know me, and I'm just getting to know you. And I find sometimes it's fun to gather around a familiar story and perhaps look at it in greater depth and with fresh eyes as we get to know each other and both kind of learn something from a passage that perhaps we think we know, but we need to hear from yet again, especially a passage like I've chosen, the parable of the prodigal son, as it's commonly called. We'll learn to call it something different, I think, by the end of our time in it. We'll be there for 5 weeks. Talk about taking a good long, hard look at a story that we think we're familiar with. We're going to be looking at the parable of what we call normally the prodigal son for 5 weeks, digging very deep into this passage in Luke 15. We're going to be leaning heavily on one of our Presbyterian brothers named Tim Keller. In his book called The Prodigal God, does some exceptional exegetical work on this passage. And while I will not be following the book piece by piece, we'll all be leaning heavily on his study. Good preachers don't take credit for things they didn't do. I did not come up with the insights that we'll be sharing, but I'm borrowing heavily from Pastor Keller and hopefully packaging them for a relevant space for us to learn together as God's people. Before we go to God's word this morning, let us ask for his wisdom as we do so. Please join me in a word of prayer. Almighty God, this morning we ask that your word go forth and that it enter our hearts and that it enter our minds and that it change us, Lord, that we might look more like your son, Jesus Christ, for we pray in his precious name. Amen. For those of you that are not able to be with us, I'm waving hi to those that will see this. And even though for those of you that are here, it's going to be a series where it will behoove you to stay caught up. So even if you can't be in worship or if you're not able to tune in throughout a week, you might want to catch up because this is one of those parables that really builds on each other. And by the end, by God's grace, we'll have a much more mature understanding of it than we do from its beginning. Well, the parable of the prodigal son, as it's commonly called, begins later in chapter 15 of Luke. Be specific, verse 11. By way of context, we need to familiarize ourselves to whom Jesus is speaking, which is very, very important for a deeper understanding of Luke 15. So we're actually going to first just read the first couple of verses to hear who Jesus is speaking to, because he actually gives three parables back to back to back to the same crowd. So we need to be aware of not only to whom Jesus is speaking, but that helps us garner a sense of why he's telling these stories. His context is always critical when we're listening to Jesus' parables. So we'll start briefly in Luke 15, verses 1 and 2. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathered around to hear him, group number 1. But the Pharisees, group number 2, and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Pause there for a moment. Our introduction to the parable of the prodigal son cannot begin until we understand the context of Jesus' surrounding. He is speaking to two groups of people in particular. He's speaking to the tax collectors and sinners. So tax collectors were infamously disliked by their Jewish brethren because they were basically mafia employees of the Roman Empire to steal money from their own people. That's basically how it worked. Tax collectors commonly skimmed off the top. They commonly taxed more than they needed to, even of their own family sometimes. Now, this is a family church, is it not? Over under on the number of last names that are in the church directory. Now, would it be hard if one of your own were to treat you in this way, and what would that do to your family? This is why the tax collectors were so disliked, because that's exactly what was going on in their context. And sinners, folks that publicly would have been sinners, not the quiet sins that we might struggle with in our heart of self-righteousness and judgment and perhaps gossip, but the more public sins, some of the ones that you know my testimony, some of the things that I've done that have been accounted for. Second group was the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, who have already a disposition towards that first group. Do you believe that Jesus asked him over to his house for dinner? Are you kidding me? Pharisees, full of themselves, that pretend that they are teachers of the law better than those that are around them, and carry a certain false sense of piety that Jesus very much looks to address. So we have two very different groups of people, people that are kind of publicly sinners, publicly kind of even hurting their own family, and groups of people that do the best they can to keep the law perfectly, but ultimately wind up using that not for any kind of gospel good, but to judge other people and, in a sense, gain power. Because one of the things that was true about the Pharisees is because they could stand in a false sense of piety, they often elevated themselves in their circles of power and used that to garner influence. Now, this is important because, as we'll see very quickly, the parable of the prodigal son, as it's often called, is not just about one son. It's about two sons. It's about a younger son, who I think most of us know pretty well, but it's actually just as much, if not more, about the older son. And that's going to be the work that we do to understand what Jesus is really getting at this parable. And those two sons are represented by the two groups of people that are mentioned at the beginning of the chapter. The tax collectors and the sinners would have been identified with the younger son in the story. And the Pharisees, those that had a false sense of piety, would have been represented by the older son in this story. And Jesus is not talking to one or the other. He's talking about both. And the real key to understanding this parable, friends, is that it's not even about the two sons. It's really about the Father. And we'll see that as we understand the story more and more. We're going to break it down each week. Today we're going to start with a focus on traditional kind of understanding of this passage with the younger brother. There's a lot of cultural stuff that we need to understand about the younger brother and his relationship to his father to understand the rest of what Jesus has in mind in this very well-known parable. So now we can turn to the parable itself, which begins in verse 11. And this is where we typically begin the story. Remember, Jesus has already preached two parables, the parable of the lost sheep and the parable of the lost coin. So the story starts this way. Jesus continued into his third parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything there, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will sit out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and sinned against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come home," he replied, "and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." May God add a blessing to the reading of his holy word. A wonderful story. We've all heard it many times. Most of us have, and it's riveting, and it's very touching, and it has a lot to it. And I want to, like as I said, I want to build on it. But we're going to start by looking at that younger son, that younger brother in the story, to understand the depth, two things, the depth of what he did to his family and the depth of what his father did for him upon his return. Both are deeply powerful. Remember, we are not living in today's world. We are 2,000 years ago in a Middle Eastern context, a very patriarchal society. Even for the most conservative families, where Lisa and I believe that I'm the head of the household and we are mutually submissive to one another, and that even under more conservative biblical ethics, we don't have a point of reference for what a Middle Eastern patriarchal family would have been like 2,000 years ago. It's truly a foreign concept to us. So the kind of nuance that we first see in the younger brother is much more than just a spoiled brat in our country going to his father asking for money. It's much deeper than that. What we find in the prodigal son and the younger son and the younger brother is he's actually dividing his family in half and insulting his father to the greatest degree. For the younger brother to go to his father and ask for his inheritance first would have communicated this: "I don't love you, I don't respect you, and therefore you're worth more to me dead than alive. I would rather it be to me that you were dead and that I would just get what is owed to me in virtue of being your son." I can't imagine hearing that as a father. See, the words on the page give us an indication, but they don't give us the full picture. Secondly, in order for the father to honor that, having already been deeply disrespected, having been dismissed, having been told that he's worth more dead than alive, you know, the wealth of a family back then does not exist like a family wealth might exist now. Dad didn't call his Edward Jones stockbroker and say, "I need 33% of my shares traded, and will that be in my money market account by Friday?" Believe it or not, that's not how that transaction went down. His wealth would have been tied in land and in cattle and in goats and sheep. And that land and those goats and those sheep and them cattle would have been an extension of the man himself. So not only would he be forced to sell things that were not easy to sell, but it would have been fracturing himself. For to own that land and to own those livestock were an extension of who he was. So the younger brother is doing far worse than even dismissing the life of his father. He's literally breaking up his family. He's breaking up the family name altogether. The depth of insult and dismissive actions on the younger brother's part are almost unfathomable, but they are what lies before us. And his plan is to go down the path of self-actualization. I'm going to dismiss my family. I'm going to dismiss my roots. I don't care how bad I hurt them. I just care about me. And I want to leverage everything I can to get as much out of my family as I possibly can. Now, that radical act of disobedience and disrespect is only matched by the way that the Father, and actually more matched by the way that the Father receives him home. All the manner in which the Son went to disrespect his Father, the Father actually disrespects himself with what the world would say a foolish way of receiving a disrespectful son back would be. What's interesting is we see the heart of both the Father and the Son and the way that the Son prepares to go back to his Father. If you notice, the speech that he prepares for his Father is not the speech he delivers to his Father when he actually sees him. When he hits rock bottom and he realizes that, man, I've got nothing, I'm a fool. How many of my father's hired men live better than me? I can't even get the scraps that pigs eat from people that see my lowly, pitiful state. I will set out and go back to him and say, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. But when he actually sees his father, he leaves out that last part. In verse 21, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son, period. He wants to admit his sin, but he really doesn't even want the consequences of what he has coming to him. He doesn't deplore his father to make him like one of his hired men. So even his heart in coming back to the Father isn't really truly contrite yet. Because he doesn't want to even receive the consequences that are due to him. He just wants the grace that he needs to change his situation. Which makes the Father's response so amazing. We know from the story that the Father sees the Son. And before the Son can even come to him and give him that speech, how many of you ever done something and you were practicing what you're going to say to your mom or your dad? You ever done that before? Man, y'all know my story. I've done some stuff. And I've had those moments like, okay, how do I play this? Okay, Dad, you're super great. I'm not great. I messed up again. I'll paint the house this summer. Just don't take my car away. Gee golly whiz, when you're little, I just don't want to be spanked. So how can I package this so it's not as bad as it really looks? I had a propensity to sneak candy out of the cupboard, I get caught and I only had one candy bar when I had five. So it's a negotiation of how bad I really did something. That's what the son's doing because he's anticipating this big kind of response. But the father just runs to him. He doesn't even allow him to give him the speech. He doesn't even allow him to lie to himself anymore. He throws his pride away. He throws his dignity away. And disregarding every culture and norm, which would have given that father the right to give his younger son the business, give him the business hard, he does the exact opposite. Throwing his pride and dignity and even what we might call self-respect away, his goal is to restore his son through grace. And so he runs to him and he teaches him, not with the harshness of his tongue, but with the strength of his embrace. And he holds him. And if sacrificing his self-respect, and if spending unlimitlessly all of his dignity that his son might taste the grace that comes with true forgiveness, he goes beyond that and spends more of his wealth, the wealth that his son had already wasted and squandered. He goes more. He starts with his own clothes. Bring my best robe, which would have been his own. There wasn't a best robe that he didn't wear. He was the dude. It was his robe. And that was a sign. He took his best robe and he wrapped it on his son. He goes, you're mine. You're home. And we will celebrate. And the best of what was left from his cattle that he inevitably already had to sell because of his son's departure, bring that animal to me and we will kill it and we will feast and we will spare no expense. There will be no expense spared for the way we welcome my son home because he was dead. And now he's alive. Now I know we're country Presbyterians, but that deserves an amen. There we go. But you start to see the power of the cultural unpacking of this story. We know it's about messing up and we know it's about forgiveness, but we need to see the depth of it. The story is entirely about who the Father is, and it takes both the sons for us to see that. There is no sinner in this room, including myself, that is not welcomed by the Father in this way. As lavish and as crazy and as prodigal, which means sparing no expense, recklessness, as the Son is, he is nothing compared to the Father. Because the Father spares no expense, including what it costs himself on the deepest level to welcome sinners like me and sinners like you home. But the challenge of this story, and why we know it's about the Father, is that the younger brother is not the only sinner in this story. The older brother is too. The one that did all the right things for all the wrong reasons. And that's going to be what we look at next week as we continue further into this story. But this week, this morning, as we look at this and kind of set the stage culturally, because we're going to learn a little bit more about what it cost the Father to welcome back the Son into full sonship and what that actually cost the older brother, why the older brother was so mad. It goes beyond actually killing the fatted calf. It actually cost the brother even more, and we'll learn about that next week, to bring the younger son back, the younger brother back. But our job for this week is to see the depth of our sin and not have it be completely blown away by the depth of the way our Father loves us and receives us back. That's why I love the Bible. It's so clear. There might be those of us that struggle with different kinds of sin, but you know what the Bible does? It says we're all dead. We're all dead in our sin. We're all equal in our sin. See, the gospel, friends, is not about making bad people good. It's not about that. It's about taking people that were dead in their sin and making them come alive through Christ. So let us pray a prayer of gratitude for our Savior, who spares no expense, including the cost of himself, to welcome us home, to put his robe of righteousness. King Jesus puts his robe of righteousness around us. And he throws a feast of heaven because we're no longer dead, we are alive. We are no longer lost, we are found. Would you pray with me? Lord, as we enter into this story more and more, as we dig deep into your word, we see the depth of our sin, but we see the amazing love that you only offer. Lord, if we are not overwhelmed by the way you love us, break our hearts because we have hard hearts. Lord, we bring nothing to you but our sin. But you bring nothing to us but your grace and your redemption because of the work of Jesus. So we praise him, Lord, in song. We praise him in prayer. We praise him as we submit to his word. And we will even praise him yet as we leave, being ambassadors of his grace. For we pray in his name. Amen. We'll continue in our worship, friends, as we consider how we can give all of ourselves in response to this amazing grace, our time, treasure, and talents. As you know, we are not collecting an offering right now. There's a box in the bank of the sanctuary. But as you listen to this beautiful offertory, consider how we might give more of ourselves, not just our finances, but our time and our talents, as all of our life is a living sacrifice to the King.
I am immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord. victorious warrior, commanding King of Kings, mighty conqueror, the only time, the only time I ever saw him run. When he ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest. He said, my son's come home again. He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, you know I still love you. He caught me by surprise. When God ran, the day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. And I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night, I remembered his love for me. And down that dusty road ahead I could see, it was the only time, the only time I'd ever saw him run. Then he ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's gone home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, you know I still love you. He caught me by surprise and brought me to my knees when God ran. And I was so ashamed, all alone and so far away. Now I know he's been waiting for this day. I saw him run to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. I felt his love for me again. He ran to me, he took me in his arms, held his head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, he called me son. He said, son, you know I still love you. Caught me by surprise and brought me to my knees when God ran.
So Lord, we offer these things, the fruit and labors of our lives, Lord, our time, our talents, and our treasures, because they all come from you. They are not ours. You've given them to us to steward to your glory, that we might have the eyes that Jesus has to see the kingdom that he is building through your grace and your redemption, your resurrection, that the kingdom of God come here on earth as we prayed earlier, as it is in heaven. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. And I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your ways. And step by step you'll lead me, and I will follow you all of my days. God, you are my God, and I will. I will follow you all of my days.
Amen. Amen. Well, for both our closing prayer and benediction, I want to use a prayer from the New Testament. The Lord laid this on my heart this morning. And so let us receive a prayer of Paul from the book of Ephesians as both our closing prayer and our benediction. Having gone in prayer and song and heard powerfully from God's word, hear now this prayer. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever, and all of God's people said, amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.